This video, we are going to talk about a few guidelines for writing good stories with a good foundation of what stories are and how to identify key user roles and the role of acceptance testing. Now we turn our attention to some additional guidelines for writing good stories. On a large project, especially one with many user roles, it is sometimes difficult to even know where to begin in identifying these stories. When faced with a large story, there are normally many ways of breaking it into smaller pieces. The first inclination of many developers is to split a story along technical lines. For example, suppose the team has decided that the story a job seeker can post a resume is simply too large to fit in the current iteration and must be split. So the developers may want to split it along the technical boundaries, such as the first story will be a job seeker can fill out a resume form, and the second story, information on a resume form is written to the database. In this case, one story would be done in the current iteration, while the other story would be deferred until the next iteration. The problem with this is that neither story on its own is very useful to the users. The first story says that job seekers can fill out a form, but that the data is not saved. Not only this is not useful, it would actually waste users' time if we are not saving the data. The second story says that the data collected on the form will be written to the database. Now, without a story to present the form to the users, the second story is also not useful. So far better approach is to write the replacement stories such that each provides some level of end-to-end functionality. Now we can refer to this as slicing the cake. Now each story must have a little from each layer. So this leads to splitting the story. A job seeker can post a resume in a different form, like the first story can be a job seeker can submit a resume that includes only basic information such as name, address, and education history. And the second story can be a job seeker can submit a resume that includes all information an employer may want to see. Now, stories that represent a full slice of cake are to be preferred over those that do not represent the complete information. Now, there are two reasons for this. First reason, exercising each layer, like as we have discussed, slicing the cake so that every layer will have some contribution in that story. Exercising each layer of an application's architecture reduces the risk of finding the last minute problems in one of the layers. And second reason is, although not ideal, but an application could be released for the use with only partial functionality, as long as the functionality that is included in the release slice or slices are all the way through the system. So next guideline is to write closed stories. Now a closed story is one that finishes with the achievements of a meaningful goal and that allows the user to feel that the user has accomplished something. For example, suppose the job portal website project includes a story as a recruiter can manage the ads which have been placed. Now, this is not a closed story. Managing the ads which have been placed is not something that is ever completely done. Now, instead, actually, it is an ongoing activity. So, the story can be better constructed as a set of closed stories, such as first story can be a recruiter can review resumes from applicants to one of the ads. Second story can be a recruiter can change the expiration date of the ad. And the third, a recruiter can delete an application that is not a good match for the job. And you can go on. You can write multiple small stories. Now, each of these closed stories is a part of the original story, which was not closed. After completing one of these closed stories, a user is likely to feel a sense of accomplishment. So remember that stories also need to be small enough to be estimatable and small enough to be conveniently scheduled into the single iteration. Now, next guideline for good stories is to put the constraints on the card. Always follow the practice of annotating a story card with constraints. For any story, that must be obeyed rather than directly implemented. An example can be seen on this slide. Even though constraints card do not get estimated and scheduled into the iterations like the normal cards, but still they are very useful. Constraint cards can be tapped on the wall and it can act as a reminder also. Better way is acceptance test can be written to ensure that the constraints are not violated. For example, it would not be difficult to write a test for this story card which is on the slide. So the system must support peak usage of up to some number of concurrent users, and then you can consider this as a constraint also. Ideally, the team would write this test during one of the first iterations when there is a little chance of it being violated. The team would then continue running the test as part of each subsequent iteration. Whenever possible, and it is usually possible, to write the automated tests to ensure that constraints are being met. The next guideline for good stories is to keep the UI out of the discussions or out of the stories. So keep the UI out as long as possible. Now, one of the problems that has created or that has been created in almost every approach to software requirements, that it has been mixed the requirements with solution specification. That is, in stating a requirement, a solution is also either explicitly stated or implied. And most commonly, this happens with the aspect of the user interface. Generally, when the end user or the intended user tries to explain something about the requirement, some specific requirement, we usually start drawing the diagrams. So you want to keep the user interface out of your stories as long as possible. For example, consider the story card present on this slide, which is a story from a real system. Now, if this story is to be developed early in the life of the project, it includes too many user interface details. The readers of this story are told about the print dialog, printer list, different ways of searching, and a lot of things. Eventually, it will become inevitable, actually, for user interface details to come into the stories, but not in the initial stage. This happens as the software becomes more and more complete, and stories shift away from being entirely new functionality to being modifications or extensions or of the existing functionality. Now, there are a few other guidelines for good stories. The first one is some things are not stories. You cannot represent everything in story format. While user stories are a very flexible format that works well for describing much of the functionality of many systems, they are not appropriate for everything. If you need to express some requirements in a form other than user stories, then do so. For example, user interface guidelines are often described in documents with lots of screen captures and diagrams. Similarly, apart from any user stories, you may want to document and agree upon an interface between two important systems. So go ahead and do that. If you find that some aspect of a system could benefit from expression in a different format other than user stories, then use that format. The next guideline for good stories is to include user roles in the stories. So if the project team has identified user roles, they should make use of them in writing the stories. So instead of just writing a user can post the resume, you should write a job seeker can post the resume. The difference is minor, but writing stories in this way keeps the user in the forefront of the developer's mind. The next guideline is to write for one user, considering one intended user. Now, stories are generally most readable when written for a single user. For example, consider the story, job seeker scans remove a resume from the site. Now, it is not clear from this story that job seekers can remove only their own resume or some other resumes also. So you have to write these stories for one user. The next guideline is to write in active voice. So user stories are easier to read and understand when they are written in active voice. For example, rather than saying a resume can be posted by a job seeker, you can say a job seeker can post a resume. The next guideline is customer rights. Ideally, customer rights these stories. On many projects, the developers may help out either by doing the actual writing during an initial story writing workshop or by suggesting new stories to the customer. But responsibility for writing stories resides with the customer and cannot be passed to the developers. The next guideline is don't number the story cards. So the usual reasoning is that this will help to keep track of individual cards or add some level of traceability to the stories. Like for example, if we discover that story number 12 is too large, then we can split that story number 12 or card number 12 and replace it with cards like 12.1, 12.2 and 12.3 and so on. Numbering story cards adds pointless overhead to the process and it may lead us into abstract discussion about features that need to be tangible. If you feel compelled to number the story cards, instead, what you can do is you can try adding a short title to the card and use the title as shorthand for the rest of the story text. And the last one, last guideline, is don't forget the purpose. Don't forget that the main purpose of a story card is to act as a reminder to discuss the feature. Now keep these reminders brief. Add the details you need to remember where to resume a conversation, but do not replace the conversation by adding more details to the story card. So these are the few of the guidelines for writing good stories.